بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله والسلام عليه. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. إخواني، والحمد لله، the month of Ramadan is upon us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this amazing opportunity to witness this month, the most amazing of the months which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created and made His creation, He favored some things above others. So for example, out of the messengers, He favored Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Out of the angels, He favored Jibreel alayhi salam. Out of the rest of mankind, He favored the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the days of the week, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increased the blessings and made the day of Jumu'ah the best of the days. Just like this month of Ramadan, it is the best of the months. So this has been chosen specifically by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He has increased His blessings in this month. In this month, the Quran was revealed. And in this month, as Muslims, we strive to do as much as we can, strive to make the most of this month. But subhanAllah, you always find at the end of this month, you look back and you think, I could have done more. And you are full of regrets for not maximizing your time within this blessed month. This is always the case. You always think, I wish I didn't do this. I wish I implemented this into the month of Ramadan. Or I wish I abstained from this. I wish I would have said this, or that I wouldn't have said this. And so what I'm going to do today, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, is bring you about 10 points. 10 points that each and every single one of us here can really implement into this Ramadan and implement within our lives to make this month, insha'Allah, the best Ramadan that we've ever had. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this month the best of those Ramadans that have passed. And bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this Ramadan and every single Ramadan better than it, better than the last. So the first thing that we should mention when we come to this amazing month and this amazing opportunity is that we should straighten our intention. We should straighten our intention. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told us that indeed every action is according to its intention. So every single action that we do is motivated by an intention. There's nothing that we do except that there's an intention. Whether it be sitting here today, this was motivated by an intention. An intention drove us to be here today. And when we are upon this month, Ikhwani, the first thing that we need to do is straighten our intention. Why are we fasting? Why are we fasting? Are we fasting because our family is fasting and our friends are fasting, so we don't want to be seen as the odd one out? Are we fasting because we want to lose weight? Are we fasting because it's fashionable? You know, this is just what the Muslims do. The Muslims don't even pray. They might not come to the masjid even on a Friday, but subhanAllah, you'll still find that they fast. You'll still find that they fast. Are we fasting because it's fashionable? Or are we fasting because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to fast in the Quran, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to fast in his authentic sunnah? The way that we can judge and we can gauge our intention, are we sincere? Ask yourself a very simple question. Be very honest with yourself. If I was in the middle of a desert, or if I was in a cave, or if I was thousands of miles away from any person, so nobody can see me except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would I still be fasting this month? So if nobody could see me, would I still be fasting in this month? If the answer is even, you know, 1% in your heart, you think, maybe I wouldn't have fasted this month. That means that you are not 100% sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to straighten our intentions that we are doing this sincerely and solely for the sake of Allah. We don't want any recognition. We don't want to fit in with the rest of the Muslims. We don't want to lose weight or improve our health. No, we are doing this because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to do. We are doing this, even if nobody knew, then we would be fasting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The great scholar Ibn al-Mubarak rahimahullah, he said that maybe a small action is made great because of its intention. Or maybe a great action is made small because of its intention. What does this mean? It might be that you do something very, very small, very minor, and to you, it's just like a fly off your shoulder. It's a very minor action. But subhanallah, you do it sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, because of that intention, that action becomes magnified and it becomes massive and huge in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or it might be that you do a huge action, like fasting 30 days, 30 hot days, when we need drink, we need food, but you fast. But because your intention was not correct, this great action is rendered null and void. You don't get any reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, when you say, "Oh Allah, I fasted," Allah will say to you, "Go to those people for whom you fasted. Those people who you wanted to impress, so you fasted. Go to them and see if they can reward you on this day." Because you never did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah will not reward you for it. So ikhwani, we have to make sure that we're not oppressing our own souls. This is a huge oppression. That we do all of this and then at the end there's no reward except that we are just hungry and we are thirsty. Ikhwani, we need to secure the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the most important thing is that we straighten our intention. If we do this, imagine, you know, you go to sleep. Even going to sleep can be an act for which you are rewarded. So you go to sleep with the intention, "Oh Allah, I am sleeping, so that with your permission, when I wake up, I will have more energy, so I will worship you." If you make this intention before you sleep, subhanallah, every second that you are asleep will be counted as an act of worship for you. And it will be rewardable bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Because you straightened your intention. So ikhwani, this is a reminder. Point number one. Straighten your intention. Before you do anything, ask yourself, why am I doing this? And make it sincerely and solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. The second thing that we can do is we can schedule and we can monitor our daily acts of worship, our daily ibadat. So schedule them, you know, monitor them. How much Quran did I read today? Okay, I read 5 pages. Tomorrow I'm going to read 5 pages and 2 lines. And then the day after I'm going to read 5.5 pages. And then the day after I'm going to read 6 pages. So schedule and monitor your acts of worship. Your acts of worship. So for example, after the Dhuhr prayer, I'm going to sit for 5 minutes and read Quran. Okay, yesterday I sat for 5 minutes. Today I'm going to sit for 7 minutes. Today I'm going to sit for 8 minutes. You know, yesterday I read Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah and Allahu Akbar. Now I'm going to add Ayatul Kursi to that as well. Now I'm going to add additional surahs from the Quran. So build each day upon the day that went past. Don't burn yourself out. You know, at the beginning of Ramadan, we're so full of energy. We think, you know what, today is the first fast. I'm going to read 30 pages of the Quran. So we read 30 pages. But then when it comes to the second day, we think, subhanallah, it's exhausting. Mentally, physically, I'm not able to do that. And so you stop. Wouldn't it have been better to read 3 pages? And then the next day, read 3.5 pages and 4.5 pages. And before you know it, subhanallah, after 10 days have passed, you've maybe read 200 to 300 pages rather than just reading 30 and then burning yourself out. So pace yourself. Pace yourself. Don't overburden yourself. Pace yourself and monitor these acts of worship. Am I doing as much as I did yesterday? If not, why? And then when you come to that reason why, then address that issue. If you need to rest, take a rest. But then pace yourself after that. So that's the second point. The third point is that we should avoid distractions. Avoid distractions, make the most of your time within this month. Ikhwani, subhanallah, if you went home tonight and a member of your family said, I'm leaving in 2 hours, I'm leaving, and you may never see me again, I don't know if I'm ever going to be coming back. Would you go and turn the TV on and sit and watch the TV? Would you go and play Xbox? Would you go out with your friends? No. Why? Because you think, I don't know if I'm ever going to see this person again. So what I'm going to do, the last 2 hours that I have, I'm going to make the most of them. And I'm going to sit with this person. And I'm going to enjoy their company, etc., etc. The same thing, ikhwani, with Ramadan. Already we are a few days in, subhanallah. We are a few days in, 3 or 4, 5 days in. Before we know it, we'll be halfway through Ramadan. Before we know it, the last 10 days are upon us. Before we know it, we're looking for Laylatul Qadr. Before we know it, we're saying, when is Eid prayer? So this month, it comes like a flash and it goes like a flash. Don't waste your time in this month, ikhwani. How many people were stood next to us in the Taraweeh prayer and now they are lying in their graves? How many people were eating with us and now, subhanallah, they're no longer with us? Ikhwani, those people would give the world and everything in it to just pray 2 rak'ahs of prayer. Just 2 rak'ahs. Now that they've seen the true reality, they would give anything to give £1 in charity. They would give anything to come back and fast just one more day, fi sabilillah. So don't, when you come home from school or come home from work, turn the TV on. Don't go out and just indulge in lewd speech. Ikhwani, don't waste your time. Every single second that passes, you're never going to be able to get that second back. So make the most of that second. Live like this is your final Ramadan. Because wallahi, nobody knows that they are going to be here next year and to be fasting again in this blessed month. That's the third point. The fourth point is that we should avoid eating excessively. Ikhwani, subhanallah. Subhanallah, in this month. In this month, you find people put weight on. Rather than losing weight, you know, you fast and you only have one meal or 1.5 meals or 2 meals in a day. Subhanallah, people get fatter and they put weight on. Because they fast all of that day. And then when it comes to iftar time, their eyes are huge. And so they fill their stomachs. And they eat and they eat and they eat until they have to lie down. Because they have no more energy. They've had so much food, they can't actually eat anymore. There's no energy left, ikhwani. Ask yourself a very simple question. Why do we eat? We eat to nourish ourselves with the permission of Allah, that we regain our energy. But look what you've done. You've had so much food, now you feel tired. In fact, you've actually gone against the whole purpose of eating. Rather than eating, and now you have energy, you feel alive, you feel awake, you feel ready to pray the Taraweeh. Now you've had so much food, you need to lie down, you want to go to sleep. So instead of actually attaining the objective of eating, you've actually gone and you've attained the complete opposite. And rather than benefiting you, it's actually harmed you. And Al-Hasan Al-Basri rahimahullah, he says that the test of our father Adam alayhi salam was food. And that we will be tested with food until Yawmul Qiyamah. How true is this? It takes a lot of discipline. It takes a lot of discipline. You've been fasting. And now all of this amazing food is in front of you. It takes a lot of discipline for the man to say, you know what, I'm not going to fill my stomach today. I'm not going to fill my stomach today. Just as Adam alayhi salam, our father, rushed to eat from the tree, The same way when the food is presented in front of us and we are hungry, we rush to eat and we eat and we eat and we eat until subhanAllah, what you actually do is you're harming yourself and you're going against the recommendation or the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he said in a hadith which is recorded by Imam Ahmad, At-Tirmidhi, An-Nasa'i and Ibn Majah, no human being has ever filled a vessel. So no human being has ever filled a container or a vessel worse than his own stomach. If you need to eat, then sufficient for any son of Adam are some morsels of food to keep his back straight. SubhanAllah. Look at the guidance of the Prophet alayhi salam. Why are we eating? To keep our back straight. You know, when you are hungry, you feel tired, you're no longer walking upright. When you sit down, you slouch in your chair. The Prophet alayhi salam is saying, it's enough to have a few morsels of food to keep your back upright. Keep your back upright, keep your energy levels up. And then the Prophet alayhi salam, he says, but if he must, then 1/3 is for his food. 1/3 is for his drink. 1/3 is for his breath or for his breathing. Ikhwani, subhanAllah, when we eat so much. 3/3, all of it is for our food. And then we eat the dessert on top. And then there's nowhere left for our breath. SubhanAllah. So you feel tired. And the person has to lie down and he falls asleep. He falls asleep. When he wakes up, he feels sick because his stomach is full. When he stands for prayer in the Taraweeh, he feels tired. His mind is not able to focus. When it comes to the suhoor, he can't really eat because he's feeling sick from the previous meal because it was so much. So subhanAllah, you've ruined your whole schedule. You've ruined your whole evening and your whole night. And then he's going to suffer the following morning because he didn't eat the way he should have. And so he has no energy for the rest of the day. Ibrahim An-Nakhai, rahimahullah, he was one of the teachers of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. He mentioned that the people before you, they were ruined because of three things. Too much talking, too much eating, and too much sleeping. Too much talking, too much eating, and too much sleeping. During the day when we are fasting, we talk too much. When it comes to breaking our fast, we eat too much. And then that leads us to sleep too much. Ikhwani, loss upon loss. Imam Shafi, rahimahullah, he says, I have not filled myself, so I never filled my stomach in 16 years. In 16 years, because filling oneself makes the body heavy. It removes clear understanding. It induces sleep and it makes one weak for worship. How true are the words of Imam Shafi, rahimahullah? It makes your body heavy. Imagine, we all have experiences. You've gone somewhere, you've had too much food. Your body now feels heavy. It removes clear understanding. When you're praying the Taraweeh, if somebody said to you, what was the last ayah that the Imam just recited, you wouldn't even remember. Because you have no clear understanding of what's being recited. You feel tired. The Imam said it induces sleep. You feel tired. So you're standing there and your head is nodding off and then you come back. And then you're nodding off and you come back and it's torture. Praying the Taraweeh is torture. And when you, at the end of it, if somebody asks you, you know, what was recited in the prayer today? You say, wallahi, I don't actually know. So you've wasted 2 and a bit hours of your time. And then the Imam says, it makes you weak for worship. So when you're full, can you sit down and recite Quran? No. You'll recite a line and then you begin to feel tired. So ikhwani, control your eating. Control your eating and bi-idhnillahi ta'ala you will control your good deeds. And this is what the scholars of the past they used to say. The one who takes control of his stomach takes control of all good deeds. And how were the Salaf? How were those who preceded us? Al-Hasan al-Basri again, rahimahullah, he offered some food to his companion. So he's sitting with a man, he offers to give him some food. And the man says, you know, I've eaten until I'm full. I don't have any space left. I've eaten and now I'm full. And Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, he says, SubhanAllah, does a Muslim eat until he is no longer able to eat anymore? He was shocked. He was saying, Subhanallah, you're a Muslim and you've filled your stomach until you're no longer able to eat. He was shocked that this was the case of the Muslims. This is the fourth thing. The fifth thing that we should do in this month is recite the Quran abundantly. Recite the Quran until you're unable to recite anymore. And then continue to recite. Ikhwani, this month is the month in which the Quran was revealed. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. That this month is the month in which the Quran was revealed. A guidance for mankind. Clear proofs for the guidance, the criterion. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah. Imam Az-Zuhri rahimahullah, he used to say upon the coming of Ramadan, it is only about reciting the Quran and feeding the poor. So look how they were. Look how the Salaf were. Look at those people who preceded us. The scholars of this ummah, when the month of Ramadan would come, they would say it's only about Quran and feeding the poor. Feeding the poor. So you spend all of this time reciting Quran. When it comes to breaking the fast, you feed the poor. So you get his reward for his fast. And all of those people who you feed. And you also get the reward for reciting the Quran. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said that whoever reads a letter from the book of Allah, he will receive a hasana. And a hasana is multiplied by 10. So you receive one good deed. But each and every good deed that we do is multiplied by 10. So for every letter of the Quran that you recite, you get 10 good deeds. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he then clarified this. He says, I do not say that alif lam mim is one letter. Rather, alif is a letter. وَلَامٌ harf, and lam is a letter. وَمِيمٌ harf, and mim is a letter. So alif lam mim, subhanallah, three letters, 3 times 10, 30 good deeds. 30 good deeds for just reciting alif lam mim. Ikhwani, imagine if you recite one page of the Quran. How many letters? One line, say there are 20 letters in one line of the Mus'haf. 20, that's 200 good deeds for reciting one line, Ikhwani, subhanallah. And then, if there's 20 lines in a page, 20 by 200, subhanallah, 4,000 good deeds for reciting one page of the Quran. Ikhwani, we have to be businessmen. We have to be business-minded. My time is precious. What's going to give me the most amount of reward for the least amount of effort, least amount of time? No doubt, reciting the Quran in this month is going to give you the most amount of reward for the least amount of time. So let's recite the Quran as much as we can. The sixth thing that we can do is implement the sunnah into our day-to-day lives. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. That for you in the Messenger of Allah, there is the best of examples. So follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Implement his sunnah into his daily lives. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبَكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me. Allah will love you and forgive you of your sins. And Allah is oft forgiving, most merciful. Which Muslim is there in this month who doesn't want to attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We all want to do this. So the way to do this is to implement the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Anas radiallahu an, he narrates in a hadith which is recorded by Imam At-Tirmidhi, whoever cherishes my sunnah, indeed he cherishes me, and he will be, and he, afwan, whoever cherishes my sunnah, indeed he cherishes me, and whoever loves me will be with me in Jannah. Ikhwani, subhanAllah, do you want to be with the Prophet alayhi salatu salam? Then we need to cherish his sunnah. We need to love his sunnah. We need to implement his sunnah. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he says, whoever revives an aspect of my sunnah that is forgotten after my death, then he will have a reward equivalent to that of the people who follow him without detracting from their reward in the least. SubhanAllah. So go home to your families. Go home to your families. And if they are not implementing a sunnah, for example, the adhkar for entering into the bathroom, leaving the bathroom, entering into the home, what you say before you eat, after you eat, before putting the clothes on, all of these different adhkar. Putting the right foot first when you enter into the home. Putting the right foot on first. All of these, ikhwani, these are different aspects of the sunnah, which if in your household they are not being practiced, teach them to your children. Teach them to your wife. By bringing this sunnah, by reviving an aspect of the sunnah, every single person, ikhwani, who does this, because you taught them, because you reminded them, then you are going to have the same reward as they have without removing any of their reward. And look at the scope for reward. You teach your children. After your death, your children teach their children. And they teach their children. Because it started with you, ikhwani, every single person, who now implements this sunnah because of a reminder that you gave, some knowledge that you taught, ikhwani, you are going to get the reward in your grave. That was the sixth thing. The seventh thing that we can do is plenty of nawafil prayers. Plenty of voluntary actions, voluntary prayers. As in the hadith Qudsi, which is recorded by Imam Bukhari, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that my slave continues or keeps coming closer to me through performing the voluntary deeds until I love him. So we perform those obligatory actions which are obligatory upon us. They bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do we continue to come closer and closer to Allah azza wa jal? Is by doing those deeds which are voluntary actions. And of course, of the greatest of the voluntary actions is to pray, ikhwani, to pray additional raka'at. But if you can only pray a certain number, then pray these 12, which I'm about to mention. Because by praying these 12, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build you a house in Jannah. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith, which is recorded on the authority of Habiba bint Abu Sufyan radiallahu anha, and is recorded by Imam Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a house will be built in paradise for every Muslim who offers 12 units of prayers other than the obligatory ones in a day and a night to seek the pleasure of Allah. So you offer these 12 units of additional prayer, only seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah azza wa jal will build you a house in Jannah. Imagine that, subhanallah. If we say 1 minute for every rak'ah that we pray, 1 minute on average. So take 12 minutes, there's 12 rak'ahs, which means it's going to take you an extra approximately 12 minutes, say 15 minutes. 15 minutes in a day, 15 minutes out of 24 hours, we pray these 12 additional units of prayer. And because of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build you a house in Jannah. Imagine, subhanallah, if somebody said to you, give me 15 minutes of your time, 15 minutes every single day, and I will give you a house the size of Buckingham Palace. The size of Buckingham Palace, I just want 15 minutes every single day. I want 15 additional minutes. Every single one of us would rush. Every single one of us would rush. And we would say, you know what? Don't take 15, you can have a whole hour. You can have a whole hour if at the end of it, I get a huge mansion. Ikhwani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promising us through the Prophet alayhi salatu salam that he will build us a house in Jannah if we just pray these 12 additional units of prayer. What are these 12 additional units of prayer? These 12 golden units of prayer which every single one of us should be praying, implementing it. If you don't pray it in the other 11 months, this month is the best time to implement it because it's going to become habit by the end of the month. You do it 30 days, day in, day out. Inshallah, by the end of the month, it's going to become a habit. You're going to do it for the rest of those 11 months. They are the two rak'ahs of sunnah prayer before Fajr. Two rak'ahs before Fajr. The four rak'ahs before Dhuhr and two after Dhuhr. The two sunnahs of Maghrib and the two of Isha. Subhanallah. The two of Fajr, that's two. The four of Dhuhr, that's six. The two after Dhuhr, that's eight. The two after Maghrib, that's 10. And the two after Isha, that's 12. Ikhwani, these 12 units of prayer. And look at the reward, subhanallah, a house in Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala build us a house in Jannah. That's the seventh thing. The eighth thing is to do excessive dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Excessive dhikr of Allah azza wa jal. Excessive remembrance of Allah. Keep your tongue moist with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let your tongue dry out. You know, whatever you're doing, whether you're driving, every time you change gear, just say subhanallah. Every time you change up, say Allahu Akbar. Whatever it might be, ikhwani. Implement the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into your daily life. Into your daily life. Even if you, whatever it might be, just implement the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into your daily life. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in a hadith which is narrated by Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu and recorded by Al-Bayhaqi, the people of paradise will not regret anything except one thing. So the people have taken their positions in Jannah. They will not regret anything except for one thing. What is that one thing? Was it, you know, that they never made jihad fi sabilillah? Was it that they never made an extra hajj? Was it that they never looked after their parents? No, the people of Jannah, they will regret nothing except one thing alone. And the Prophet alayhi salam said, the hour, 1 hour that passed in which they made no remembrance of Allah. This is the thing that they're going to regret. How could 1 hour pass in the dunya and I never remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And it's going to be a source of regret for them, even though they are in Jannah. So ikhwani, don't let 1 hour pass, especially in this month, where you don't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, he narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, which one of the servants of Allah is best in rank before Allah and Yawm al-Qiyamah? And then he said, the ones who remember Allah much. And then Abu Sa'id al-Khudri says, I asked, O Messenger of Allah, what about the fighter? What about the one who fights in the way of Allah? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, even if he strikes the unbelievers and mushrikeen with his sword until it breaks and it becomes red with their blood, truly those who do dhikr are better than him in rank. This hadith is recorded by Imam Ahmad, Tirmidhi and Bayhaqi. I'm going to bring to you 10 or some different things that we can say within this month. Very light, ikhwani, but bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, heavy on the scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah. In the last 10 nights, when the last 10 nights of Ramadan, they came, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he encouraged his wife with one dua. He encouraged his wife Aisha radiallahu anha to make this dua. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anni. Oh Allah, You are forgiving and you love to forgive, so forgive me. And if you want to say it for your family, Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna, so forgive us. So when you are in sujood or you are just walking into your home, You want to ask forgiveness for your whole family. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Oh Allah, you are forgiving and you love to forgive, so forgive us. We can say subhanallah. We can say alhamdulillah. We can say Allahu Akbar. We can say la ilaha illallah. All of these things. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said two words which are easy and light on the tongue, but they are heavy in the scales. What are they? Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahil azim. Two words, ikhwani, subhanallah. The Prophet alayhi salam is telling us they are light on the tongue, and subhanallah, when you say them, they actually roll off the tongue. What the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was saying was the truth. Sadaqa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. So easy, so light off the tongue. Subhanallah al-azim. So light, so easy, they roll off the tongue. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, they are heavy in the scales and they are loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we have the simple statement. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. This statement about which the Prophet alayhi salam, he told us that a man is going to be brought on Yawm al-Qiyamah and he is going to be shown 99 scrolls of evil deeds, and they are for as far as his eye can see. They are going to be placed on the mizan. They are going to be placed on the scales. And he thinks that he is being destroyed. He thinks that he is being destroyed. But then it will be said, no, there is one good deed which we have not yet added to your scale of good deeds. And it is that statement of La ilaha illallah. And a card will be bought. A card will be bought. And on that was his uttering of that statement, La ilaha illallah. Ikhwani, when that one card is placed in his scale of good deeds, it will outweigh those 99 scrolls. Subhanallah. Such is the weight of this statement. So don't belittle this statement, ikhwani. Don't belittle this statement of La ilaha illallah. This is of the highest branches of iman, as the Prophet alayhi salatu salam told us. The highest branch of iman is the uttering of La ilaha illallah. And the lowest branch is to remove something out of the way, out of the pathway. Other things that we can do, ikhwani, that was the eighth thing. The ninth thing that we can do in this month is to make plenty of repentance. Make plenty of tawbah in this month. And we don't need to go through somebody. We don't need to go through a medium. We don't need to go through a peer. No. We make dua. We ask repentance. We ask for forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَإِذَا سَعَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانٌ. When my servant asks you concerning me, then tell them that I am indeed close to them in my knowledge. And I listen to the prayer, or I listen to the dua of every supplicant when he calls upon me. Subhanallah. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he told us in a hadith recorded in Sahih al-Jami' that nothing is more honorable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than dua. Nothing is more honorable. So dua is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allaha yuhibbu at-tawwabina wa yuhibbu al-mutatahhirin. Truly Allah loves those who turn to Him in repentance and those who purify themselves. Ikhwani, subhanallah. Allah loves it when we turn to Him in repentance. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told us that if you people never sinned, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy you. Allah would destroy you and bring a people who would sin, and then they would turn back to Him in repentance so that He could forgive them. This is how much Allah loves to forgive the one who sins. Allah absolutely loves it, ikhwani. And Allah is the one who will continue to forgive you. Doesn't matter how much you sin, the shaitan will come to you and try and whisper and say, you know, you fall into this same sin every single time. You can't turn back to Allah now. إخواني الله سبحانه وتعالى, if you sin a million times and you turn back to Allah with sincere repentance a million times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you a million times. There is, in fact, Allah's mercy is infinite. We can't even put a number on it, إخواني. What are the conditions of sincere repentance? You know, there's no point committing a sin and then we say, I'm repenting, but we're not fulfilling those conditions. In general, there are three conditions, إخواني. The first thing is that you stop that sin. You stop that sin. So you know you're committing a sin, you want to repent. You can't be listening to music and then say, oh Allah, forgive me for listening to music. No. You have to stop the sin that you're doing. This is the first condition, that you stop the sin. The second condition is that you feel regret in your heart. You feel bad for sinning. You feel bad for disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who created you, the one who sustains you, the one who has blessed you with Islam. You feel bad for disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third condition is that you make sincere intention never to fall into this sin again. And the fourth condition, if it applies, is that if you are wronging somebody, or if you have taken the rights of somebody, then you return those rights, if that is applicable. But if the sin is just between you and Allah, then these three conditions apply. When are times when the dua of a Muslim is accepted? The first time is the last third of the night. The last third of the night. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends in a way which befits His Majesty. We don't ask how, we don't ask why, we don't try and explain it, we don't try and compare it to something. No, Ikhwani. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam told us that Allah Azza wa Jal descends in the last third of the night. We accept it, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us. This is when Allah Azza wa Jal descends. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. And He asks, who is there that is asking so that I may, you know, answer his dua? I may give him what he is asking. So this is one of the best times, the last third of the night. While we are fasting, make plenty of dua. Increase in your dua. We have left our food and our drink for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is beloved to Allah Azza wa Jal. Make dua. Seek a means of tawassul. You know, make dua, oh Allah, I've left my food and my drink for you. And then make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we can make dua while we are fasting. We can make dua just before the fast opens, or we are about to break the fast. When we are on a journey, we can make dua. When our head is in sujood, we can make dua. Before the adhan and the iqamah, we should make dua. On the last 10 days, we should also increase in our dua. Ikhwani, subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made dua against his own ummah. He made dua against his own ummah. When did he do this? The hadith is in Bukhari, and it also has been recorded by At-Tabarani. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the angel Jibreel, he appeared before me and he said, destruction to the one who came upon the month of Ramadan and he let it pass by without gaining forgiveness. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said ameen to this dua three times. Three times he said ameen to this dua. Destruction to the one who he entered into the month of Ramadan, and he never exited the month of Ramadan without being forgiven. And so the Prophet alayhi salam, he said, ameen, ameen, ameen. Subhanallah, he made dua against those people who they don't seek forgiveness and they are not forgiven by the end of this month. That was number 9. Number 10 is that we need to control our tongues. We need to control our tongues and try and have the best character. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best amongst you are those who have the best manners and character. Hadith in Bukhari. Ikhwani, subhanallah, the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he said, there is nothing heavier in the scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah than good character. Recorded by At-Tirmidhi and Abu Dawood. Subhanallah. Have good character. Have good character, good manners. Don't speak out of turn. When the elders are speaking, when your elders are speaking, don't cut them. Don't, you know, butt in and don't cut into the conversation. Think before you speak. Don't backbite. Don't engage in lewd speech. All of these things, subhanallah. The fast is not just about leaving food and drink, ikhwani. The fast is about leaving all of the sins. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, fasting is not about abstaining from eating and drinking only, but also from vain speech and foul language. If one of you is being cursed or is being annoyed, he should say, I am fasting, I am fasting. So if somebody is disrespecting you or is abusing you, you should say to that person, look, I'm fasting, I'm fasting. Don't retaliate. Don't swear at him the way he's swearing back at you. No. Just say, I'm fasting, and leave the situation. This was recorded by Ibn Khuzaymah and Ibn Hibban. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was asked, which of the Muslims is best? And he responded, one who the other Muslims are safe from his tongue and from his hand. This is a hadith in At-Tirmidhi. So the Muslims are safe from his tongue. The Muslims are safe from his tongue. Ikhwani, while we are fasting, this is especially challenging because our patience is very low. We don't have as much sabr. You know, somebody says something to us where normally we would have smiled and just ignored the situation. Now we are angry. We want to argue because our patience is low. Our patience is wearing thin. So the one who has true good character and can control his tongue and is actually patient, that person, when his patience is wearing thin and somebody says something to him, this is the one who actually says, you know what, I'm fasting and I don't want to retaliate. This is the one who, subhanallah, he is the patient one. He is the one who can control his tongue. That was number 10. Number 11. Increasing our worship in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Increasing our worship in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. The first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, they are the best. But the last 10 nights of Ramadan, these are the best without any equal, ikhwani. And this is the night or the period in which we look for Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr khayrun min alfi shahr. Laylatul Qadr is better than 1,000 months. Laylatul Qadr, subhanallah, one night, you are praying, you are reading Quran. It's like that worship which you've done, subhanallah. It's like doing that for 83 years. Imagine, subhanallah, this is the mercy of Allah upon the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she narrated in a hadith which is recorded by Al-Bukhari. When the start of the last 10 days of Ramadan would begin, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to tighten his waist belt and he used to pray all the night and he used to keep his family awake for the prayers as well. He used to tighten his waist belt. This means he used to increase his effort. He used to really say, you know what? Now I'm going for it. And he used to pray all of the night. And he also used to wake his family up as well. Don't pray while your family are asleep. In the last 10 days of Ramadan, wake them up, lead them in prayer. Wake them up, lead them in prayer. Wake them up, encourage them to read Quran, to increase in their dua. Ikhwani, subhanallah. This is a great way, you know, to increase your ajr, but also to get the reward from your family as well. Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, I asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, O Messenger of Allah, if I know that this is the night of Laylatul Qadr, what should I do? And he says, say, Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anni. This is hadith recorded by Imam Ahmad ibn Majah and At-Tirmidhi. And the 12th and final thing, subhanAllah, is that we should increase in our charity, increase in our generosity. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as is reported by Ibn Abbas, recorded by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, Ibn Abbas said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the most generous of men. And he was most generous during the month of Ramadan, when Jibreel alayhi salam visited him every night and recited the Quran to him. Look what Ibn Abbas says. During this period, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his generosity was like the rain bearing wind, the wind bearing fast rain. Imagine it's rainy, it's raining, and it's very windy. The water from that rain will cover everything. It will cover everything, it will touch everything. Everything will be touched by this water. The same way, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in this month of Ramadan, there was nothing except that it was touched by his generosity and by his charity and by his giving sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ikhwani, subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, righteous deeds protect a person from evil, and charity spent in secret extinguishes Allah's wrath, and maintaining good ties of kinship increases a person's lifespan, as was recorded by At-Tabarani. Ikhwani, all of these things, these 12 issues which I've mentioned, nothing really outstanding, nothing really difficult, nothing really exceptional. Just things that we can try and do to implement into our day-to-day life. The first thing to summarize is that we purify our intention. Make it sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second thing, monitor our daily worship. Make sure and aim that we are doing at least as much as we did yesterday, if not more. And we definitely should be doing more than we were doing last Ramadan. The third thing, we should avoid distractions. Put your Xbox away. Put your TV away. Put your PC away. Put everything away which is going to take you away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth thing, avoid eating excessively. Control your eating and you will control your good deeds bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. The fifth thing, recite Quran abundantly. Recite. Ikhwani, increase in the recitation of Quran. Ramadan is the month of the Quran. The sixth thing, implement the sunnah into our day-to-day lives. Make it a habit so that when we come out of this month of Ramadan, we are still doing these little sunnahs which we should implement in the month of Ramadan. The seventh thing, increase in our voluntary prayers. And I focused on those 12 rak'ahs. I focus on those 12 units of prayers, which if we do them, insha'Allah bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we will have a house built for us in Jannah. The eighth thing, increasing in the dhikr of Allah. So tie, you know, when you go past a certain place on your way to work, say, you know what, when I pass this building, I have to say subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi al-azim. When I change gear, when I get on the bus, whatever it might be, link your day-to-day life with making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ninth thing, make dua, make tawbah, make istighfar, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The tenth thing, behave in a way which you are perfecting your character and control your tongue. The 11th thing, increase your worship in the last 10 days of Ramadan. Seek Laylatul Qadr. Seek Laylatul Qadr and encourage your family to do the same. And the 12th and final thing, increase in charity. Even if you give £1 a day, increase in your charity and generosity. Feed the people, because bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, as these blessed and fortunate brothers are going to do when they feed us bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, they are going to have the same reward as our fast without diminishing our fast. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this Ramadan the best of all of those Ramadans which we have experienced. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the subsequent Ramadans which are coming better than those which have passed. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our istighfar and our tawbah and our ibadah and our generosity and all of our acts of worship. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept them and make them a proof and an evidence for us and not against us. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.